end with this. Bishop Cardinal Cong said something to the Chinese when he was about to be imprisoned. And they said, well, how do we, you know, we understand that we're Catholic and we have a devotion to Christ, but the government is trying to crush us, right? And another Jesuit by the name of Zhang, or Chang Bei Da, was asked, can you compromise and go to the side of the government, right? How far does accommodation go? And Chang Bei Da said, well, we'll compromise on the non-essentials, but not on the essentials. And what's the next question? What are the essentials, right? It's very interesting. Well, Ricci represented to the Chinese at that time an ability. From their point of view, Ricci understood the essentials. See, for them, there is a line between what is essential and non-essential. That's important. Just the fact that there is a line between the essential and non-essentials. If we go too far, we're no longer Christian. And what Cardinal Cong said after Chang Bei Da had said this, and his fellow Christians, Catholics in Shanghai, saying, what do we do? Should we accommodate to the government and live, or should we remain loyal to the church and to the Pope? And I'll end with this. And thinking about Ricci, I think, Cardinal Cong said, if we resist the government, we will disappear. And there will be a resurrection. That is, if we stay loyal to the truths of our faith and resist the government, we will disappear. And there will be a resurrection. If we compromise on the essentials, if we do not resist, we will also disappear. But there will be no resurrection. So people resisted, and they disappeared, and they suffered, and the church got bigger. So Ricci said, he constantly says this, be loyal to the teachings of the church and know what the essentials are, and the church will grow. We can't compromise. So I think that's the true Ricci. That's the Ricci I want to represent to you. The Ricci I want to represent to you is the Ricci of Cardinal Cong and the Ricci of Chang Bei Da. So not the Ricci of the map maker. Anyway, so any questions? Thank you. Yeah.
So what next in China?
What next in China? That's a really complicated question. I think the church in China, I mean, what do you mean by how will the church survive right now? Right now, there is almost no place left where there is a distinct division between the so-called above ground and underground church. So right now you see a collaboration. That is, there's a kind of a new way of operating in China. That is, the new way of operating is, let's not be at odds with each other. The government has pushed so much the division, has emphasized so much the division between the patriotic and the underground church. That is, the government wants the underground church and the patriotic Catholic community to be at odds. That's a policy in the government. It's an official policy, by the way. And they know that. So now, for the first time ever, underground bishops and above ground bishops live together. That's true. I when I visited Bishop Hu Daguo, who said, as long as communism is in China, in his words, Satan will strangle the church in China. Those are his words. And he said that the underground church was thriving, but he lived with the patriotic bishop, and they collaborate together. So there's a new collaboration that's happening right now between the underground and the above ground. And most of the offices of the patriotic, the Ai Guo Hui, the Patriotic Association, I just gave a talk at Princeton, and the professors there said to me, so there's this Patriotic Association. So I had a slide, and the slide was pictures I've taken of the Patriotic Association front door, and it will say in Chinese, you know, the Zhongguo Ai Guo Hui, Tianzhujiao Ai Guo Hui, the Chinese Patriotic Catholic Association. And then I like to go inside and take pictures of the empty room. So the Patriotic Association offices are now predominantly empty. They're just a sign. And that's new. So what next? I think what's happening right now, that the church is flourishing, it's growing, not without struggles. Not without struggles. You can't go to Mass right now unless, patriotic churches have cameras. So if you go to mass, you're recorded. There's the Public Security Bureau actually monitors everybody who goes to mass in China right now, in the patriotic churches. So I think you see a less of an antagonism between these two communities. I think Father Lu would see a very different Chinese Catholic community today than I even knew before. So it's an interesting thing. Right now, according to the Catholics, the big enemy is the government, yes, but more than the government, it's materialism. So when I'm in China, I like to ask cab drivers, you know, 你信教吗? 你信什么? What do you believe in? I think 100% of the time the answer I get is 我信我，我信钱. I believe in myself and I believe in money. So it's frightening to me. So the Catholic Church right now in China sees itself as, we want to stay holy, we want to stay loyal to Rome, and we want to train our priests to be orthodox theologically, and we need to fight the government and this materialist society by just being good and holy. So what next? That's a good question. That's a good question. But that's sort of the MO right now in the church in China. I think there are horror stories still there. Yes?
I'm sorry, which part of that? Did you already cover the canonization controversy about Matteo Ricci? I read about him and Robert De Novoli when I was a child.
Sure.
And they were both presented as sort of equals in a bunch of saint descriptions. And I kind of grew up thinking they were both saints, and then I found out, well, no. Matteo Ricci actually, they canonized him, and then they took it away, and then they put it back, and Robert De Novoli that actually was canonized for it on the way, and he never got it because
sure.
He became too much of a Brahmin.
I'm an official researcher in the Vatican archives, and I work with the canonization cases. Like I read the canonization cases for all the canonizations in China, and I've never seen a single document of Ricci's possible canonization. That's a document that's at the Congregation for the Cause for Sainthood. They have that. So the Vatican archival records have nothing. I've been there, so there's nothing. So I don't. Rumors fly, I can tell you that. I know a lot of rumors that fly all over the place in China and elsewhere, but I'm not aware of any documents in the Vatican archives or the Cause for Saints archives that mention that Ricci has ever been really canonized or even, it's really right now is when it's happening. He's now considered a servant of God. So he'll be a blessed if he's beatified. I think the big holdup right now for Ricci's beatification, one is that he burnt his documents, and that doesn't look good. I mean, it doesn't look good. So it's like Thomas a Kempis, huh? Well, there you go. So, you know, like Thomas a Kempis, there's all this stuff about his final, you know, the last few minutes of his life, that there are controversy about beatification and canonization. I think Ricci was very holy, and I personally, I leave this to the church. I personally don't see the obstacles. I think Ricci and miracles associated with him, I wouldn't be surprised. I wouldn't be surprised. So I'm a big fan of Ricci. I think he's absolutely misunderstood. So if I seemed a little apologetic for Ricci's apologetic methods, it's because I live in China. I hear about how Ricci wasn't Christian. And it's just absurd. But